back, everybody. Let us know how you're feeling about everything that we discussed. Right now, we're going to talk more, but this time is about a beloved topic I just can't get out of my head. It's COD.
Yeah. Well, and yeah. It makes a lot of money every year. We all bought Ghost. It sucked. Call of Duty Ghost sucked. Okay.
The last Call of Duty I played besides Warzone. I came back for Warzone, but after Ghost, I was like, never again.
Never again. I was like, oh, dogs, cool. No, this sucks. This sucks. But yeah, they make lots of money. We're dealing with Activision. Activision knows what's up. They're not going to stop the money train. I think them focusing on keeping Warzone as a games of service, that's the right move. Mm-hmm. Will they just have like one studio as like the Call of Duty studio and amalgamate all these different studios? Probably not, because their systems are so different, and different communities within Call of Duty like different systems because of that, right? Like, I know so many friends that really got into Call of Duty because of Modern Warfare, but they hate Black Ops. I love Black Ops, just because it's so classic, but I also like Modern Warfare, and you have all these different communities within. So I think for Activision now, what they're trying to do is trying to serve every community at once. Will we feel like, you know, their product starts deteriorating? Maybe. Like, maybe it is getting to that time where we don't need the annual releases. Like, Caboose, you mentioned that Assassin's Creed took a year off. Yes. A year. They made it seem like they were taking more than a year off, but they only took a year off. And then they came back to regular annual releases, right? So I feel like studios, yes, especially AAA studios, yes, they want to do what's right. And this doesn't necessarily reflect the developers, but it does reflect the people that are at the top of the boards making the decision, making the big bucks. They're not going to stop selling products that they know are going to sell. So we're going to keep seeing annual releases of Call of Duty. They're going to continue to recycle World War I, World War II, Modern Warfare all the time. It's just going to be now a question of how they integrate that into Warzone. Malik, you brought up a really good point. Like, they could kind of wipe Verdansk and then do like a 50s theme thing. But I think that would be too risky for Warzone to do, because a lot of people are treating Warzone as if it's like what was like what PUBG was, you know, what Fortnite is, Apex Legends. They want this game to kind of stay the same with minor updates for the long haul.
Yep.
And I think the only way that Warzone could accurately do this, because it is frustrating sometimes week after week you're finding out that there's new games, they're nerfed, and like it's just a lot to keep up with, especially if you're also playing multiplayer on both games, Modern Warfare and Black Ops. There's a lot to keep up with. I feel like what they have to do, and we spoke about this before on the podcast, is maybe do a different map of Verdansk, where it does rotate and change, and they have their core map of Verdansk, the one that they have right now, as like the competitive map. What that will do to their servers, I have no idea. And I think that's the complicated thing, how they would be able to manage that much data on their servers.
Right. And on top of that, it's also, Call of Duty is taking money from people buying in-app purchases, buying skins, buying new guns and stuff like that. They have to uphold that moving forward. They have to balance it so that, you know, moving forward, you're adding new content this year with World War II, but then also not saying that, okay, well, all the stuff you've already purchased or have received by grinding it out or anything, that's all wiped clean.
Yeah,
there's a middle ground here where they have something to uphold with the community, and I think it's a tough spot for them to be in, to be honest, because how do you sell a whole community on a World War II only Warzone map, but then also allow them to use the stuff that they've already accumulated and spent money on in the past 2 years.
Exactly.
That's really hard to sell to someone.
Yeah. Go ahead, Malik.
No, I was just going to say, almost how Destiny has their like planet set up and how there's like different modes that you can select through there. So integrating something like that into Call of Duty would be cool, especially if if it ever does get to the point where like World War II Vanguard and the Cold War Black Ops, those are just $30 add-ons to the base Call of Duty app, and then you can select that mode or that, you know, type, whatever, whether it's, you know, you have specialized maps within Warzone. I think that there's ways that you could bring it all under this one like umbrella application or like system, and then allow people to choose. But doing that as well, you're exposed. When I hopped back into Destiny 2, I was like, oh, what's that? That's a cool planet. Oh, that looks cool. Like, there's missions here now. Like, it puts it right in front of people's faces and says, hey, we have new stuff. This is the other stuff you could be doing with your friends. We're constantly adding new content. And then it doesn't feel like Call of Duty's adding another game this year. It's like, yo, Call of Duty's adding a big expansion this year. Mm-hmm. You flip the branding in people's brains, because that's what's kept Destiny alive for so long, is those content drops.
And you know what? You're absolutely right. Like, that, maybe that's the route to go. When you go to the home screen, and this really changed when Warzone was introduced, they have it now when you're logged in, even if you're in a party. You see, like, Warzone, then you see Black Ops Modern Warfare, and you could just go with from your party, pull your party if you're already in Warzone, and then go into any of those games as long as they have those games, or it's like a free access weekend. So maybe that's kind of like what they're trying to do. Again, I don't fully think they will have it where it's like you have full access to the game if you have Warzone just for $30. That's half the money that they're going to be making off that game, right? It wouldn't make sense. Plus, when you look at the campaign of Call of Duty games, they are really well done. Graphics, the capture, the storylines. Think about how much money that goes in just to the campaign. Maybe if they were to allow, if you have Warzone for $30, you could get the multiplayer for that year's Call of Duty. Maybe that's something that they could work on, so then you're able to kind of get a feel of that game, but you don't have to buy into the full experience. But then again, that could kind of hurt how many people actually get to experience the campaign game.
Sure.
Yeah. Steve. Go ahead.
No, please go.
Well, you had mentioned, like in your opening, about how do you make World War II weapons feel good?
Yeah.
Utilize PlayStation's new haptic feedback. That's a big selling point. I get it's not quite there yet, probably, but that is a way you could sell it on PS4 and make it, you know, get a little bit of that marketing and that brand recognition, since they aren't, you know, doing that competitive with PS4 anymore. You can still kind of have that cooperation, but other than that, I really don't know how you make World War II weapons feel good, because that's never been my wheelhouse.
You guys don't. Catlin guns would be cool.
And maybe I didn't phrase it like the way I intended it for it to come out. I'm sure that they'll be able to do it just fine using the Modern Warfare engine and everything. I just don't know how compelling it is to say to a player, okay, you can use this bolt action rifle, or you can use the MAC-10 that's in Cold War. Like, well, I just don't know, like, how you can sell. And then
they don't have to sell it. They nerf the gun. They force players into it, and that's the downside when you have things like that. And that's the real challenge with Call of Duty right now. It's like when they introduce Black Ops gun, the Pellington was so great because they nerfed everything from Modern Warfare. They forced you to play Black Ops guns. And then it made people, with early access being around that time, they were familiar with the guns, they hop in to Black Ops and they sell the game to people through there, right? It's just manipulation at that point, right?
You're absolutely correct. Right? But then I also wonder, like, what about loadouts? How do you make a full gun with all these attachments, silencers, grips, and everything? It's like, this wasn't in World War II. Come on, Activision.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, right. And that's kind of like the challenge too with Black Ops, because with Black Ops you have your wild cards, right? Instead of your perks, right? So they've had to kind of find pretty much in Warzone that doesn't exist. That method of your loadout for Black Ops is not in Warzone. It's just the guns. And then you have all these other attachments from Modern Warfare that you could put on Black Ops guns. It's kind of like this universe. Verdansk is kind of like this world in between everything from Call of Duty. It's like this makeshift environment. And I think that's
they have to kind of go with that. They have to be like, you know, it's just whatever we put in here. It's kind of like Fortnite. Whatever's going to happen, it's going to happen. There's going to be zombies. They're going to move to different areas. Then we're going to have Jigsaw from Saw come in, and you're going to be able to get those skins as well. Plus, there's a fairy off the beach, and we don't know what we're doing with that yet, but it's going to be something, right? So I feel like players can't necessarily take it too seriously. I feel like, and maybe I'm going to get some backlash from you guys.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I think they should just double down and say, whatever. Like, Verdansk or whatever this new map is going to be, whatever goes. Like, we're just going to sell you a product. You guys are going to buy it up. No one's going to complain.
Exactly. And, you know, maybe it is who they're selling their game to. Now, we are in this era of, like, cross-platform, and I think Warzone works really well for that. But at the heart of it, Call of Duty is still a console game. It's still made for console. That's why Black Ops has that haptic feedback. It works well in campaign, not too much when you're playing multiplayer, but that's why they're able to integrate things like that, because it doesn't really interfere too much with your, like, your controller. But it would for a mouse and keyboard. You're not getting that same experience as you would if you're using your PlayStation 5 controller with haptic feedback and triggers and everything like that, adaptive triggers. So I feel for Warzone, and Malik, maybe you could speak more to this, you're kind of looking for that PC FPS experience, you know? You said how Modern Warfare is still broken on PC. Would you really want to see Vanguard on PC, and how long would you play something like Vanguard? Because people play that year's Call of Duty for the full year. I feel like PC players, because they have so many other games that are made for PC, just will try it and then flip the switch and go on to something else. And that's why so many PC players are on to Warzone, because it kind of has that balance.
Yeah, and really too, it's kind of interesting, because this past week I picked up Jedi The Last Order, and I was playing it just with my mouse and keyboard, and then finally I was like, you know what, I'm just going to plug in my controller and see how it goes. Mm-hmm. And the game was completely different. I forgot. The last time I played a cinematic game with a controller was Ghost of Tsushima, like months and months and months ago. So I forgot how good a game can feel on a controller.
Yeah.
Call of Duty could draw me back in again if it felt good. That's the big thing. I wouldn't mind playing Call of Duty and Warzone on my PS4. I never really got into it on PC just because it was super buggy, and I just wasn't a fan of the controls. So I think Call of Duty at its heart, like you said, is a console game. Like that kind of just nails it right there for me. I probably wouldn't jump into a World War II because I like the fast-paced action. What I go to Call of Duty for is that fast-paced Modern Warfare action. I don't want to, you know, be shooting a bolt-action rifle. I just want to hop into Warzone, you know, pick up an M4 and just go. I think that Call of Duty has a lot of potential. And when you start listing off all these things that they have, really they're just setting up safety nets for themselves. They're like, we don't know what we're going to do with that yet, but we've got something. Don't worry. They always have like this safety net to back them up. And to me, that's just kind of reiterating the point that they really think that Warzone is their savior.
Yeah.
Like, that is them truly showing that in case everything else fails, Warzone is going to keep us alive. And like you kind of said, how are you going to give someone a gold-plated Mosin that's shooting red tracers and make that look okay, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that they really, after this, depending on the success or lack thereof of this title, I think we may see Call of Duty really just start to double down on the Warzone and Modern Warfare brand.
Sure.
Mm.
But you, like you said, there are people who like those different interactions, and I think that they're going to have to figure out something, because if people aren't spending the money on the game, there's no point in Activision investing in making these games, right? Mm-hmm. If you're not getting that return, just double down on what's working for you and make smaller content packages that you can put as like gameplay modes, like you said, like have a period where it's like almost season pass. Like, guess what? Next 3 months, we're going, you know, back to the 50s. And then they do just like kind of mid-annual, you know, semi-annual package drops.
Yeah, I feel like there's two different systems that they have to kind of do coincide. I think they need one studio just to control Warzone, which they already have. And then as they have their annual releases, because we know that's not going to go anywhere. And if you have to think about it like this, if a studio is coming out with annual releases of the same game every year, they're not looking at the long haul. They want people to fall off after a year to buy the next game, right? So they're just pushing out this content really quickly. So I feel like they just need to kind of maybe separate more Warzone from all their other releases. Maybe as you have a new season, which they're kind of doing, and a game coincides with that, you do an event that lasts like a few weeks, and then they move on from that. I think that's the way to do it, and maybe leave the weapons out of it.
Yeah, I think that's good enough.
I know I rambled there at the end, and you're right. There's no way that they're going to get rid of an annual release. It's just, it feels like bad development practice to me. I really wish that they would focus on what's working. That being said, though, this news has made me excited for Battlefield's new title, because I'm interested to see how they take the success of Warzone and how they translate that to whatever they're working on. Because we have seen over the years, from Battlefield 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, it's gotten less serious, less realistic military shooter, and more occupying the world of a realistic battlefield, but maintaining some of those like Call of Duty arcade-y mechanics. So it'll be interesting to see how the competition fares up, because we are supposed to get the next Battlefield 6 or whatever they're doing later this year. So I'm interested to see how these two titles come out in sales.
It'll be interesting if Battlefield kind of pushes Activision's perspective of Warzone and their annual releases.
Yeah.
I hope that Battlefield just learned a whole bunch of lessons from its Battle Royale from last year.
Yeah.
Came and went.
That was bad.
Yeah.
Bad.
Yeah. That was probably the most quickly forgotten Battle Royale out of any of them that have ever been made.
Yeah.
Like, I can't even remember the name of it.
I don't even know as well. But it'll be interesting because if Battlefield does... Because Battlefield, if it does really well, and say their next two releases, so not just this one, but the one after it, does really, really well, and they take the time between each one, would that be enough for Activision to be like, maybe we won't do annual releases as well? And especially because I feel like they are running out of material. Like, we're always just flipping back and forth between modern times, you know, the 80s or 70s, and then the 50s. So do you guys think if Battlefield's success could kind of prove or show Activision a new way of doing things?
Yes, because I just realized, too, EA Play is included with Xbox Game Pass. Mm-hmm. If you can download the new Battlefield, the day it released for free.
Oh,
that's a good point.
That's huge right there. That's a huge move.
Well, EA Play doesn't do day and date.
Right. They could do something. Yeah. They could
do like a partnership, like a marketing thing.
I'm just saying, if they give people like a free week, or like you get to play it early, you know, for free on EA Play through Xbox Game Pass, that could be huge for them.
For sure.
Because EA Play is on PlayStation as well. Yeah. So they could, that's exciting for me. What do you guys think? Sorry.
I don't think it's that plausible. Activision really, really just looks at the numbers, like the dollar sign. To be honest, and I really don't think that they're too concerned about what their competitors are doing until it affects their sales. Until Call of Duty is not number one or number two on the sales numbers every month, they're not going to worry about whatever they're doing. They're just going to keep doing the exact same thing year after year. But I mean, if people are kind of sick of it, just vote with your wallet. Don't pick up this game, and eventually Activision will start changing things. But until that happens, it's the same with EA and like Madden and stuff. You see it all the time. Their sales speak so much more than like what competitors do, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I agree. That was kind of sad, but true as well. But you have a good point. Vote with your wallet, right? If you're not interested in seeing the same thing over and over again, don't pick the game up. And then developers or publishers will have to actually recognize that and set different goals for their releases.